we stopped searching for him. But I remember getting the call on November the 7th, and I heard the distress in my mother's voice saying, "Annilia, I don't know where my baby is. Say, Mom, I'm buying a flight. I'm on my way home." So I flew to Texas. I put together teams of people. People flew from all over the world to come in and help us. But in that time, I saw God in ways that I never thought I would see him. They said my brother committed suicide, but my brother never did drugs. But in our society, that is one of the, I say, scapegoats when there's a cover-up. But I can safely say here today that you never know where life will take you. It doesn't matter how ugly it gets, how scary it gets. I'm a testimony today that God is still able to get you through. While other families are enjoying themselves, like I said, this is a rough time. Because after 18 days, after the 7th, that's when we found my brother's body and just went through the grueling things. Many of you all don't know, but it made the headlines. CNN, the top television station in Europe, flew down and interviewed my family. But I believe justice is going to come for Alfred Wright, my brother. And in that, I want to segue to Hannah. Just like Hannah prayed for her son, I'm praying for justice for my brother. I don't know if I'll ever see it, but one thing y'all can say, God said, "Vengeance is mine, and I will repay." Hannah is one of the most favorite women in the Bible that I admire. I admire her tenacity. I admire her patience. I admire her determination. I admire her prayer life. Because no matter how long she had to endure not having what she desired, she still prayed. She still did what God called her to do. She still was a great wife. Even though she dealt with the disappointment of not being able to give her husband a son. Isn't it like society today? Back during that time, a woman being able to give a son to her husband, that was the highlight of their life, to give their husband a son. Even today, that tradition, that mindset have traveled all the way to 2009 when I got pregnant with my son. I didn't know I had a son, but I prayed, "Lord, let me get a son. Lord, I want to give my husband a son." But that's society. And a lot of times we look at what society tells us that will make us valuable. But how many know you're already valuable? Hannah, she didn't recognize that because she was blinded by what society told her. If she do not give her husband a son, she's not even really ready. During that time, he ended up taking on another wife because she couldn't bear children. And everybody know how that worked out for Abraham. But he took on another wife named Kenyan. Now, a lot of people try to make a lot of negative things out of Kenyan. But you know what? I can't imagine what Kenyan went through. How would you like to be second? Somebody just married you just because their first wife didn't give them children. Have you ever been chosen second? I remember as a kid playing certain sports. Sometimes I would get chosen last because at that time I wasn't the most popular kid. And you know, if you were popular, you get chosen first. But it don't feel just hired me because the person that they really want can't be here right now, or they had to take a leave of absence. Everybody wants to feel special. Everybody wants to feel worthy. Just think, many of you, you can work for a company for 20 and 30 years, but you wait to get that watch at retirement. You wait to get that ring at retirement because it's a sense of accomplishment. It's a sense to say, hey, I've earned something that so many people are wanting. But we cannot allow society to blind us of our true value. When God made you, he was trying to show out. When he made you, he made someone that could stand firm and say, I love me just the way I am. When he made you, he made someone that could love and could contribute to this world to make it better. You are valuable. Turn to your neighbor and look at him and just say, you are so valuable. So in this story, Hannah and Peninnah and Elkanah, the man, the starring role, the man, Elkanah, the husband, which I can't honor him because he was an upright man. He was a wealthy man. He was a Levite. He came from the tribe of Ephraim. And if you understand the meaning of the name Ephraim, it means fruitfulness. So he didn't have a choice. He had to be fruitful and multiple. So Elkanah, he would try to calm Hannah's spirit. Because when it was time to give his family portions, he would give Peninnah and the children their portion, but he would give Hannah a double portion. Some people may look at that text and say, oh, he gave her a double portion because he felt sorry for her because she couldn't give birth to children. Then some other people say, when they look at this text, that he gave her a double portion because he really loved her. But I believe he loved all. I believe he loved Peninnah. I believe he loved his other children. But I believe he gave her a double portion because he was trying to substitute the void that she had. But how can you know that there are certain things people cannot substitute in their lives to close a void that only God can fill? That's why we have to trust in God. And I want to go to my points. I try to deal with points so that way you can take away and you can remember the message. The first thing I want us to focus on is the word stand. Everybody say stand. I'm going to take the letters and I'm going to create a meaning behind each letter so that way when you leave here, you can hold on to this word and use it. S is for stay plugged into the power source. When we look at this text, this was a praying family. Elkanah, he was that man that believed in the text in Joshua 14. As for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. And I love to see men in the church that take on that same spirit. That say, yes, we can do all the extracurricular activities when we are away, but on Sunday we're going to come into the house of the Lord. And I can respect the men of this church. There's so many of you that come and bring your wife to church. And I know sometimes she may fool you, but you hear. Thank you, Jesus. But you come. It's very important that we pray together as a family. They have a saying that the family that prays together stays together. Prayer strengthens us. It gives us a foundation that is hard to tear and shake. and say, I'm going to trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not to my own understanding. The next thing goes to trust. T, or trust God over fear. The reason why I want to deal with trusting God over fear is because in so many times in our lives, we can know exactly what God wants us to do. But because of fear of the unknown, fear of failure, a lot of times we just stop and we won't move. We get paralyzed. But can we remember that scripture? I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. We got to learn to trust God when we cannot trace Him. And there are some tough times that come in your life where you don't know where to turn. You don't know who to trust. You've been to doctor after doctor, and you're still not getting better. Look to the hills. It's coming to help. It will come. You just have to be patient. After we trust God, A stands for associate with other leaders. Surround